Right, welcome everybody to this debate. The debate title will be, Can Christians be confident in the crucifixion and resurrection? The debate will be between a Muslim and a Christian. Representing the Christian stance will be Mwalimu Chaka, who is a seminary student at Columbia International School, CIU, which is one of the leading evangelical institutions in the Western world today. He originally comes from Tanzania, which is in East Africa. I'm sure everybody knew that. And he's a soccer fan. He supports Arsenal Football Club. Mustafa Ahmed is a Londoner, and he's a Muslim apologist and debater. He's had three moderated debates previously, including two debates with Canadian pastor Angelos Kirikidis. Mustafa has an apologetics blog, which can be found at mustafa-apologist.blogspot.co.uk. The format of the debate will be 15 minutes opening statement for each debater, likewise a 10-minute rebuttal, 15 minutes cross-examination for each participant, and finally a 5-minute closing statement for each participant. We're going to begin with the first speaker, which will be Chaka. So Chaka, if you want to take the mic and proceed with your 15 minutes opening statement now.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for this opportunity, and thank you, my brothers, who have also joined us. I take this time to thank God for granting us an opportunity to be alive today and be able to dialogue together as Christians and Muslims. We have many things that we bring us together, and certainly this is one of the things that we need to be discussing. And so I thank God for that. I want to say that may the peace of God be upon you wherever you are joining us today. I got 15 minutes. It's quite a short time to discuss such a magnitude, a big topic. As Christians, I want to say that we have many differences in our understanding of many topics, and certainly everyone knows that. But if there is one thing that joins Christians all over the world, if there is one topic that brings us together, is the belief that Jesus Christ, our Lord, was indeed crucified. Now, tonight, I'm debating a friend that actually also does believe that actually somebody was crucified on that day, on that Friday. And therefore, we have at least a common place to begin from. Did Jesus Christ die? Can we be certain of that? Can we be sure that indeed Jesus Christ died and rose again from the dead? And I want to focus majorly on the disciples of Jesus. And I will be looking exactly after Jesus was allegedly crucified, because that is the thing that we are debating. What was the message that the disciples left? And I think this is very important for us to focus on it. Now, 600 years after the alleged crucifixion event happened, there was a revelation to Muhammad saying that the Messiah was not crucified. They did not crucify him. They did not put him on the cross. And that is what we want to look at. But allow me begin from Acts chapter number 2. I will focus on the message of the disciples. Now, before I do that, I will say a short prayer, and the Lord will guide us. Father, we thank you for this opportunity. Thank you that we, as Muslims and Christians, are together on the same table, able to discuss such a way that you will lead me as I speak your word in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. So I want to take us together to the book of Acts, chapter number 2, and I will begin from verse 22. And let's look at this together. Now, the Bible says, "Fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. this man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him on the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep hold on him. Now, this is a message that is being preached in Jerusalem. This message is not preached in Medina nor in Makkah. This is in Jerusalem, the very place where the event of the crucifixion happened. Now, the message of the disciples, them that were left, the 11, and indeed 120 followers at this point, on the 50 days actually after the alleged crucifixion, and they are standing in public in Jerusalem, and they are saying, fellow Israelites, listen, that man Jesus Christ, that you all know was accredited by God, by the miracles that he performed, that man was handed over by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge. So actually the death of Jesus was a foreknowledge of God. This is the message that Peter is speaking. Now, most of the time, many folks would say, you see, the message of the crucifixion was the message of Paul. It was Paul who came and preached that Jesus was crucified. But long before Paul comes into the scene, we see that Peter is leading the 11 disciples, and indeed the 120 disciples at this point, and he is saying that Jesus Christ was crucified. And he's talking to the Jews. Now, the Jews would have only said, you know, we attempted to kill Jesus, we wanted to kill that man, but God's cunningness, God's scheme overcame our scheme, and God took him up. We crucified somebody else. We did not crucify that man, Jesus. We did attempt to crucify him, but we were unable to crucify him. But the message that Peter is telling them, you know it, and that God raised him from the dead. So two things that we are debating today, the crucifixion and the resurrection of Jesus. Right here, we see that is the message that Peter is speaking. Now, what was the reaction to the message of Peter? Let's look together at verse 29. Fellow Israelites, I can tell you confidently that the patriarch David died and was buried, and his tomb is here to this day, but was a prophet and knew that God had promised him an oath that he would place one of his descendants on the throne. Seeing what was to come, he spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah. And so Peter is actually telling these folks that whatever they are saying is actually a fulfillment of the prophecy that David had spoken about, these things, that the Messiah would be raised up, would be exalted. And so he goes back to the prophecy, back to the Old Testament, and he's telling them the things that you're seeing among yourself today have actually been prophesied long before. And I want to, and let's then see what was the reaction of the people of Jerusalem. On 50 days after this, as they listened to Peter and the disciples, what was their reaction? I'll take you back to verse 37 of Acts chapter 2. Now, when the people heard this, they were cut to their heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, brothers, what shall we do? Peter replied, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of sins, and you will receive a gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off. Now, so they're telling them, repent and be baptized. And what was the result of this message that Peter says? It says in verse 40 that with many other words, he warned them and he pleaded with them, save yourself from the corrupt generation. Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number on that day. Look, 3,000 people. We are not talking about a small group of people here. We are talking about 3,000 folks that are accepting the message of the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus. 50 days after the event happened, they know it, and they're telling, their hearts were burning. They say, if you read in verse 16, they say, we know we did these things in ignorance. Now what shall we do? Be baptized. Come, repent. Be baptized in the name of Jesus. 3,000 people are being baptized on that same day and they are joining the church. And this actually marks the day that the church of the New Testament is born. Now, Muslims would have us to believe that the church was born out of the deception, that Allah actually deceived people to believe that the person that was on Jesus on the cross was Jesus, and it wasn't Jesus. Now, why do I need to focus on the disciples of Jesus after this? Because even in the Quran, we read that the Messiah Isa is actually talking to his disciples and telling them who will join me in declaring the religion of Allah. And these disciples were found to be faithful enough and saying that, you know, we will join you to proclaim that message. And so if God wanted to take him up, if God wanted to rescue Jesus from the death, from the shameful death of the cross, why would he allow somebody else to die? Now, there is something that we need to understand here. The Muslim world is not, does not really know what exactly happened on that fateful day. If you look at the Muslim world today and even from history, you'll see that there are Muslims who accept the substitution theory. In the Quran, and as I shall be reading Surah 4, verse 157, and for their saying that we crucified Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of Mary, the Quran goes on to say that they did not crucify him, did not nail him on the cross, but so it was likened unto them. Now, various experts over the history of Islam have debated these, and they have told us many things concerning this verse. Now, there are those of Muslims who would accept the substitution theory, and they agree that somebody was substituted for Jesus. And this is where Mustafa, my friend, falls, that actually somebody else was substituted for Jesus on that day. Look, the Christians are saying Jesus, the man that is sinless, died for the sinner. Now, Muslims are saying, no. Actually, somebody else died for the sinless, died for Jesus. So Jesus actually was supposed to die, but somebody else died in his place. Now, there are Muslims who would say, no. There was no person who was put on the cross. It was actually Jesus who was put on the cross, and he swooned. And then, having fainted, somehow he found his way out of the cross, and there are so many other theories after that. Now, who was crucified, who was substituted in the place of Jesus, that is something else, again, for debate. Some have said it was Judas, some have said it was Simon of Cyrene, some have said whoever, it depends on who are you talking to. Now, some Muslims actually also believe that Jesus died a natural death. Now, that is something else we will be talking about. Let me take you back to the message of Acts chapter 3. Now, in Acts chapter 3, we find Peter and John, they have healed a beggar who used to stay at the gate begging for bread. And they come and tell him, you know, silver and gold we don't have, but in the name of Jesus Christ, arise and walk. And people saw this man had been healed. And what was the reaction? Chapter 3 and verse 11, the book of Acts, it says, when the man held on to Peter and John, all the people were astonished and came running to them to the place called Solomon's Colonnade. And when Peter saw this, he said to them, fellow Israelites, why does this surprise you? Why do you stare at us as if we, our own power and good godliness, have made this man walk? The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed him over to be killed. And you disowned him before Pilate, though he had decided to let him go. You disowned the only righteous one and asked that a murderer be released to you. You killed the author of life, but God raised him from the dead. We are witnesses of this. By faith in the name of Jesus, this man whom you see and know was made strong. If it is Jesus' name and the faith that comes through him, that he has completely healed him, and you can see. So, these guys could not deny the fact that a man had been healed in their midst. And the disciples are saying, you see, we did not do this by our own power, but by the power of that man that you crucified. Now, they would have just stopped them and say, you know what? We did not killed Jesus. We killed a shabby. We killed a person that looked like Jesus Christ. But indeed, they are saying, they are accepting that something has been done by the disciples. It is a miracle that they cannot deny. Now, look at if you look at verse 20 and 21 of the same book, actually, Peter goes on to exhort them and tell them, you know, that Jesus that you crucified, God has raised him up. And verse 17 says, and fellow Israelites, I know that you acted in ignorance, and as did your leaders. And look, he's mentioning the leaders. He's mentioning Barabbas that was released. In other words, if you do not believe, ask Barabbas, how was he released? How comes he is free? Because he was supposed to die on that Passover, but he is free. How comes he is free? If you don't believe me, ask Marcus. He was pissed off, and Jesus healed this man on that Passover. And so the events that we are talking about are events that were real. And so if you go on, it says, and Peter goes on to exhort these people, and he's telling them, you know what, Jesus, whom you crucified, you did it in ignorance, but God has raised his servant up, and he is now in the right hand of God. And we could go on and on and see. But I want to take you to the message of the Quran. What does the Quran say later? Surah 4, Surah Nisa, in verse 157, I guess this is a common verse, and I already alluded to it. Surah 4, allow me just go quickly on my Quran right here. Verse 157 is the most common verse that we are talking about the crucifixion. It says, and they said in boast. Now, this is talking about Jews. They said in boast, we killed Jesus Christ, the son of Mary, the messenger of Allah, but they killed him not, nor crucified him. But so it was made to appear to them, and those who did.
Chaka, time. Finish off your point, Chaka.
All right. They are full of doubt, with no certain knowledge of, but only conjecture they follow, out of surely they did not kill him. So the Quran comes to say that wa ma katalu wa ma salabu wa lakin shubi alahum. We did not kill him. Now, what is the understanding of this verse? That is what I'm going to come back and just argue in the next point, that indeed, what does that as the Muslim world understood this verse? Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Right. Thanks for that. So, Mustafa's going to have his 15 minutes in a moment or so, but I want to remind you, Chaka, you're not recording. I think you forgot to press record. There's no recording icon next to your name. So if you want to just start recording, go for that. And people
can you start my timing after I finish my recite my Quran verse, please? Yeah, can you start my timing then? Is that okay?
Yeah, I'll do that, Mustafa. But I just want to remind people who are in the room, please don't turn your cameras on. Nobody wants to see you. And secondly, make sure your mics remain muted. Otherwise, you will start getting booted from the room. I'm a little bit annoyed that people start turning their mics on, even though they've been muted. Okay, there's no need for you guys to turn your mics on. So, Mustafa, go ahead.
Are you all right? So, after the Quran ayat, if you just start my...
Yeah, I'll do that.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل يا أهل الكتاب تعالوا إلى كلمة سواء بيننا وبينكم الله نعبد إلا الله ولا نشرك به شيئا ولا يتخذ بعضنا بعضا أربابا من دون الله فإن تولوا فكلوا شهدوا بأننا مسلمون. Thank you, Chaka, for your opening statement. I have taken notes and I will respond to them during my rebuttal, inshallah. The topic of this debate was Jesus crucified and resurrected. I'm just paraphrased it because it will change. Now, I'm going to take this to a different approach. I'm going to talk about the events which led to the crucifixion and the event that happened after the crucifixion, leaving the crucifixion in the middle. Then I'll come to my conclusion. Now, let's summarize this. Let's recall this. Let's recall that Judas was bribed to betray Jesus in the absence of the crowds who favored him. The plan was to seize Jesus in the dark of the night, sentence him before sunrise to make everything appear legal, transport him to Pilate, stir up a mob of people to condemn him and crucify him in the morning before those who supported him were aware. Who constituted the crowd of people who arrested Jesus? The answer leads to the first blunder in Jesus' arrest, trial, and conviction. Jesus was arrested illegally. Any trial may be dismissed as a mistrial or illegal if there is prejudice against the individual being tried on the part of those participating. The accused must be given full recourse of the law to be able to sufficiently present his side. Jesus, however, was both arrested and tried by those prejudiced against him and was not allowed opportunity to present his case. Further, his judges were the same individuals who bribed Judas. Surely one cannot say these people were impartial. In addition, Jesus' arrest was secretly at night and was not formally charged of any offense. Judas simply pointed out Jesus and the crowd arrested him. There was no legal basis for this. In the book Criminal Jurisprudence of the Ancient Hebrews, Samuel Mendelssohn states, the testimony of an accomplice in the case of Judas is not permissible by rabbinic law, and no man's life, nor his liberty, nor his reputation can be endangered by the malice of the one who has confessed himself a criminal. Since Judas accepted a bribe from a judge, certainly Judas will be considered a criminal. And since Jesus' judges bribed Judas, they would be considered criminals as well. This alone should have led a mistrial. Now, the trial of Jesus with the Council of Sanhedrin bears no historical records. Sanhedrin becomes a technical term for rabbinic court. A tractate in the Mishnah prescribes procedures the Sanhedrin is to use. The excerpts taken from the Mishnah tractate may shed light on the procedures used in the case of Jesus. Let me tell you, there is no record of such a trial in the Talmud. It is unknown in its contemporary rabbinic literature. This trial was not only the source of unmeasurable trouble and persecution of the Jewish people, but it is also not logical from a Jewish point of view, as there are many disagreements between the rabbinic procedure. Who questioned Jesus? Was it the Sanhedrin or the high priest? According to Mark 14:53-55 and Matthew 26:57-59, it was the Sanhedrin who tried Jesus in the house of the high priest, Caiaphas. Who was Sanhedrin? The Sanhedrin was a Jewish council that dealt with religious and Jewish legal matters, consisting of 71 members. Luke 22:66 says, at daybreak, the council of the elders of the people, both the chief priests, the teachers of the law, met together. Jesus was led before them. One can understand from this that Luke may very well be referring to the Sanhedrin. Matthew and Mark does. But John, departing the synoptics, claimed that Jesus was first brought to the house of Annas, then the detachment of the soldiers with its commander, and the Jewish officials arrested Jesus. They bound him and brought him first to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest in that year, John 18:12-13. Only after he had been interrogated by Annas privately that he was taken to Caiaphas, John 18:24. There are multiple problems with this narrative. Firstly, the Sanhedrin is totally missing in John's account, even though he says earlier in John 11:47-53 that Caiaphas led the Sanhedrin planning to kill Jesus. If John saw it fit to mention Sanhedrin's plan to kill him, why not mention it also when Jesus was interrogated? The question then is, was Jesus ever tried by Sanhedrin, as claimed by synoptics? Who's telling the truth? The second problem that we find is that the two high priests are mentioned together, namely Annas and Caiaphas. Annas is addressed as high priest repeatedly in John 18:15-22 and the same passage in verse 24. Caiaphas is described as the high priest. This cannot be true because the Old Testament, Josephus, Philo, rabbinic material all agree that the position of the high priest can be occupied by one person only at one time. Furthermore, the eminent authority in Jewish studies, Giza Vermes, says that John's claim in John 11, 49 to 51, and John 18, chapter 18, verse 13, that the high priesthood went through annual rotation is unhistorical. The Gospel of John indicates that the Sanhedrin turned Jesus over to Pilate because it lacked power to impose death. Pilate said to him, "Take him yourself and judge him according to your law." The Jews replied, "We are not permitted to put anyone to death." The Mishnah, however, clearly shows that the Sanhedrin did have the power to impose death for certain crimes, at least sometimes before 200 CE. In particular, Mishnah, Sanhedrin 6:1 to Sanhedrin 6:4 specify the procedures for stoning. There is no evidence to suggest that such power did not exist in 30 CE. Jesus was examined by Annas in a secret proceeding, John 18:12 to 14 and 19 to 23. According to the Talmud, the Sanhedrin is forbidden from convening between the time of the evening and morning sacrifice. In the book Jesus Before the Sanhedrin, M.M. Liman states that no session, including a preliminary examination of the court, could take place before the offering of the morning sacrifice. Furthermore, an accused man was never subjected to private or secret examination. Jesus' trial could not have taken place at night and concluded the same night. The Mishnah says the capital punishment, civil suits are tried by day and night, included civil suits are tried by day and concluded at night. The capital punishment charges must be tried by day and concluded by night. Civil suits can be concluded on the day, on the same day, whether acquittable or condemnation. Capital charges may be concluded on the same day with a favorable verdict, but only on the morrow with an unfavorable verdict. Therefore, trials are not held on the eve of the Sabbath or festival in civil suits, and the case's cleanliness and uncleanliness will begin with the opinion of the most eminent of judges, whereas in the capital charges, we commence the opinion of those on the side of the benches. Sanhedrin 32a. Matthew 26, 31 to 57, and Mark 14, 30 to 53, and John 18, 28 claim that Jesus' trial took place at night. According to the Jewish law, as we have read, this cannot be true unless the Jewish leaders and the high priests were altogether ignorant, or perhaps they were involved in an evil conspiracy that they bent the law, that they bent their own law. If that is true, why isn't the error of their action exposed and rebuked in the Gospels? Why did Jesus himself question the manner in which he was tried being himself a learned Jewish teacher? As Professor Craig A. Evans tells us in The Context, Family and Formation in Cambridge Companion to the Bible, page 19, Jesus frequently called Rabbi or Rabuni. It's a Greek equivalent, Master, Epistata, or Teacher, Didaskalos. So Jesus was no doubt a rabbi. Mark 12:29. Being a rabbi and learned in the Jewish law, he would have questioned the Jewish leaders concerning the unconstitutional nocturnal trial. But no such disagreement found either from Jesus or anyone else in the New Testament. Anyone else in the New Testament. Now, coming to the next part, events after the crucifixion, who confirmed that Jesus actually died on the cross? Mark 15:37 to 39, John 19:33 to 33, Matthew 27:50 to 54, and Luke 23:46 to 48. They all confirm that it was the centurion who saw Jesus died. From the Gospels accounts, it's clear the centurion saw Jesus die. But is seeing someone die the same as confirming he really is dead? How sure was the centurion that Jesus actually died? Did he go and investigate? Did he take a close look to see if he was breathing? How did he confirm Jesus died on the cross if he didn't investigate? If someone takes a deep breath and then faints, will you say he died? Or will you first go and investigate what happened? We also read that the legs of Jesus were still intact. They were not broken. How comes? If the other robbers had their legs broken, why exclude Jesus? John, being the last gospel writer, knew this was a problem. It's obvious it was obvious that Jesus would not have died on the cross, so he invented the spear thrust to ensure the readers that Jesus really died on the cross. However, this is not true. As a New Testament scholar, Raymond E. Brown dismisses any such happening. Professor Raymond Brown does not consider spear thrusting that penetrates the flesh as part of the crucifixion process. Many of our biblical scholars simply deny there was any such incident of piercing or thrusting. Giza Vermes opines, one may further speculate that the piercing of the side by one of the executioners was a later invention introduced by John 19:34 to dispel doubts about whether Jesus was dead. Brown, R.E., 1994, The Death of the Messiah, Volume 2, New York, Bantam. Now that we've established that none of these centurions confirmed Jesus' body died actually on the cross, who took the body down? According to Mark 15:46, Matthew 27:59-60, and Luke 23:50-53, and John 19:38, it was Joseph of Arimathea who took the body down. Note, Joseph of Arimathea took the body down. The centurions did not confirm that he died by cross-examining it. Rather, it was Joseph of Arimathea. Who was Joseph of Arimathea? All four Gospels give us a brief detail. Mark 15:43, Matthew 57:27, Luke 23:50, and John 19:38. Mark tells us he was a prominent member of the council. Matthew tells us he was a rich man from Arimathea, also a disciple of Jesus. Luke tells us he was a member of the council, and John tells us he was this disciple of Jesus. A secret one. Notice how Jesus of Arimathea was the one who took the body down and no centurion did. The centurions claimed that Jesus died on the cross without any sort of cross-examination. They allowed the body to be taken down by a disciple of Jesus. Doing further investigation on Joseph of Arimathea, we find something fascinating. Now, Joseph of Arimathea, according to Luke and according to Matthew, he was a member of the Council of Sanhedrin. Luke explicitly says he was from the Judean town of Arimathea. We expect that because he'd be a Jew, a Jewish council member of Sanhedrin, he'll be a Jew. But the shock, surprisingly or shockingly, there is no such place in Judea called Arimathea. Believe it or not, guys, Arimathea does not exist. Arimathea, a city of the Jews, the homes of Joseph in sepulchre, the body of Jesus was laid. Its identity is the subject of much conjecture. The location of Arimathea has not been yet identified with any assurance. The various possible locations are nothing more than pious guesses or conjectures documented by any textual archaeological evidence. Roy Hoover in Jesus' Resurrection, Fact or Fiction, a debate with William Lane Craig, page 130. If a place never existed, why would the authors mention of it? What was their motive behind such a deception, which millions of Christians took for granted, such as Chaka? How could the authors, moved by the Holy Ghost, lie to the audience? This is why Bishop John Selby Sponge, in his book Resurrection Myth or Reality, says this is a probability that the story of Joseph of Arimathea was developed to cover up the apostles' pain at the memory of Jesus having no one to claim his body. And of his death as a common criminal. His body was probably dumped without unceremoniously into the common grave, the location which has never been known then or now. So you can see even Bishop Selby has admitted that this man, Joseph of Arimathea, has made up. Can you imagine? Now here's the problem. John tells us that Joseph of Arimathea was a secret disciple. Why would he say he was a secret disciple? Well, it's easy that if he was really a secret disciple and then John exposed him, surely the Sanhedrin would have caught him out and they would have threw him out, or they would have probably crucified him himself. But John knew this man never existed. If someone doesn't exist, there is no reason to even talk about him. The authors made up a man to fit their story. There is no man called Joseph of Arimathea. The empty Joseph story. This is why I said my conclusion with the crucifixion. If the story of Sanhedrin is a lie and story of Joseph of Arimathea is a lie, both of them are a lie, then the middle story, Jesus being crucified, is also a lie. Both stories don't match. You need someone like a jigsaw to fit. So they tried to fit both ways and it didn't happen. Why? John 19:35, the man who saw this, his testimony, the man who saw this has given his testimony and his testimony is true.
Fine.
He knows that he says Mustafa, the truth.
That he Mustafa, finish your point.
Okay. The man who has given his testimony and his testimony is true. He knows that he tells the truth and he testifies so that you may also believe. Who is this man? How can the author expect us to believe in such absurdity, basing the entire crucifixion on an unknown man? There was no man who witnessed anything. It's all made up. And I told you, so Chaka, you can please, junior rebuttal, explain to us these two problems that we have fitting prior to the crucifixion and after to the so-called crucifixion. Thank you.
Right, thanks for that. So we're going to move on to the rebuttal period now. Chaka will begin and he'll have 10 minutes to respond to what Mustafa has just said. Go ahead, Chaka.
Thank you. Peace be upon you once again. Now, thank you, Brother Mustafa, for your opening speech. Now, brothers and sisters, you will notice the first thing that Mustafa did was to begin by showing us that Judas was indeed a criminal. Now, you see, the line of reasoning that Mustafa is taking by showing that Judas was indeed a criminal, then perhaps he ought to be the one that has died, you know. And then he says that there is no record of this in the Talmud. I will come back to that. And then it says that was it the Sanhedrin or the high priest where Jesus was taken first? But notice one thing that our brother Mustafa has not told us. The debate is about, can we as Christians be certain that indeed the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus Christ did occur? What Mustafa has failed to tell us until now is what happened. If he did not die, what happened? So he's bringing all these things to just try and throw some seeds of doubt on whether indeed these stories that are written in the gospel are indeed true or not. Now, again, he says that the gospels do not agree. You know, that the way the four gospels narrate the events that occurred that Passover weekend do not agree. And it gives an example where John mentioned something that Luke and Mark did not mention, and therefore says that, you see, if this such a thing was such important, why didn't Matthew mention it? Why didn't Luke mention it? But you forget the fact that you just read that there are many things that Jesus wrote, did, and said that were not written. If everything was written, there was no amount of book that could contain the volumes. Now, for instance, only John records to us the story of Jesus turning water into wine. Now, does that make it that story fake? Does it mean that Jesus did not turn water into wine just because Luke and Mark did not mention it? No. I mean, the narrators are telling us, each one of them is giving us a viewpoint of the events that happened. Now, if you are doing a fake story today, you're not going to make a fake story and mention the leading people in the government. Look at what John and the disciples are mentioning. They are talking about Pilate. They are talking about Herod. They are talking about Rome. And if you know what the Roman kingdom at that time was the ruling kingdom, and so you do not go on mentioning all these events, because what are the disciples saying? That is talking to the people of Jerusalem and saying, listen, your leaders, Pilate and Herod and all you and the Sanhedrin, all the elders, they came together and crucified the Lord of glory. But God raised him up. So the people that were there do not cast doubt. The man that comes to shed doubt is 600 years away from the events. You see, 600 years away, God is speaking according to Islam from Makkah and Medina. He is not speaking from Jerusalem. So you need to tell us what then happened on that day. It says that the centurion, it was the centurion who actually went to make sure that, gave us the last word that Jesus has died. He's the one that spoke to the leaders of Rome that man had died. How sure was he that Jesus did? How did he investigate that Jesus was indeed the one that was crucified? Now, my answer is very simple. The Roman soldiers, they knew for sure that their life was at stake. If you come back to the book of Acts chapter 16, we see that the soldier was, when he thought that Peter, it was a Peter or Paul that wanted to escape from prison, when the angel had opened the doors, he was ready to kill himself, because he knew for sure that if something happens, his life was to be in danger. So if anything was to happen to that man on the cross, that was not true. He cannot lie to his boss. I mean, this is a soldier that is trained, and therefore, the issue is, if these other two people were broken their legs, why wasn't Jesus an exception? Why was Jesus an exception? Why were his legs not broken? First, get to know that this was actually a fulfillment of prophecy, my brother Mustafa. When you look at the Passover lamb, God is saying that the Passover lamb, the bones were not to be broken, back in the book of Exodus chapter 12. And so, Jesus as the Passover lamb, John is saying, behold the lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. The Passover lamb was not to be broken. And in Psalms chapter 34, Zabur 34 in verse 19, David is prophesying. He says the infirmities of a righteous man are many, but the Lord makes sure that none of his bones are broken. So the act of his bones not being broken is actually a fulfillment of scripture. Not only that, you also said that the invention, that this story of him being pierced was an invention. If it was an invention, then it was an invention that Zechariah had actually seen. When you read Zechariah chapter 12, he says, on that day you will mourn at me whom you have pierced. And so the piercing of Jesus Christ, the Messiah, on the cross was actually also a fulfillment of prophecy. Now, who took the body down, and you said Joseph of Arimathea took, and Nicodemus and the disciples indeed took the body down. But what you need to tell us is what happened. You see, let me, brothers, tell you what the problem we are facing today. Now, the Muslims, and Mustafa needs to state his position, because the Muslims who accept the substitution theory, and they agree that indeed somebody else died. Now, if that is his position, we will deal with it later on during the crossfire. But even the substitution stories do not agree. They are not unanimous. So if the Quran is coming to bring, to cast off the, to remove the doubt about Jesus' apparent crucifixion or not crucifixion, does the Quran then remove that doubt? No, the Quran in fact adds more confusion. 600 years later, it adds more confusion in the understanding of the Muslims today. Now, the early centuries of Islam seem to be very silent. He said the Talmud is silent, but even the early centuries of Islam seem to be silent on the issue of, because if you read the hadiths, if you read the collection of Imam Bukhari and Imam Muslim, they are silent on what happened on the crucifixion. Now, some Muslim believe that Jesus, as I said, survived on the cross and was taken, the swoon theory. They also need to state that. Now, Muslims who believe that there was no specific individual that was crucified, that Jesus was not crucified, is just a legend. You know, the crucifixion is just a legend. But let me take you back to the Quran and see. The Quran is very clear on the issue of whether Jesus or any other person survived, even before Muhammad. The Quran is very specific in saying that kullu nafsi dhaikatul maut, every soul shall taste death. In Surah 3 and verse 100 and and 44, we see the Quran is Allah is speaking to Muhammad and telling him, you know, that Muhammad is nothing. To paraphrase that, to say he's nothing more special than the other disciples, that the other apostles or the Nabis that were before him. He has many have passed before him. But even when you read the Quran in Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah verse 87, we see that Jesus, the Quran says that he was led by the Holy Spirit, that he had the Holy Spirit with him. But above all, that we see that the children of Israel, when they came to them, prophets, some of them they dispersed, some of them they killed. So Jesus dying, you know, the death of a shameful death on the cross is not something unique. Because there are many who have died before that. And some Muslims will say, well, how could God allow his servant to die such a horrible death? Look at me in Surah 3 and verse 145, and let's see what the Quran is saying. Surah 3, verse 145. The Quran says this. Nor can a soul die except by Allah's leave. No, the soul does not die but by permission of Allah. Does Allah grant permission for the soul of Isa to die? Surah 3, verse 55, this is what the Quran has to say. Verse 55, this is what the Quran has to say. Behold, Allah said, O Jesus, I will take you to thee and I will and raise thee to myself and I clear thee out of the falsehood of those who blaspheme, and I will make those who follow you superior to those who reject faith. Now, Allah is saying that I will cause you to die, I will fulfill your time, and then I will bring you up to myself. Now, was the Messiah taken up? Surah 4, verse 158 tells us that he was taken up. But for him to be taken up, this thing has to be to happen. I will cause you to die. I will fulfill your days. And then I will raise you up to myself. Now, was he raised? When we read Surah 5, 116, Isa does not know whatever
time
happened. You know, when it let me just finish on that point. So Isa is not aware of the inventions that happened before him. The Quran is very clear. When you fulfilled my days, when you caused me to die, you remained to be the judge over the people. So he does not know of the inventions that have happened after him. And so the Quran is very clear on these things, and we will talk about them on a much later time. Thank you.
Okay, well, thanks for that, Chaka. So to finish off the rebuttal period, we have Mustafa, who will commence his 10 minutes now.
Thank you very much. I don't know what to say. I mean, what a sidetrack. I mean, he was supposed to be rebutting me, but then he just sidetracked to Islam. I don't know why he done that. That could have been done during the question and answer. I think Chaka has blatantly lost the debate, straightforward. He's telling me, oh, he's telling his audience, he's trying to doubt, you put doubts in your head. Well, does it sound normal to your friends that you're actually telling them he's putting doubts in your head? You should have been like clearing up these doubts, my friend. You're telling me I didn't talk about the crucifixion and how he died. I'm telling you the problem that's prior to the crucifixion and after the crucifixion. Could you imagine that the whole story of the Sanhedrin, the problem of the trial, that you could not even justify that? It's a problem. The Jews, no wonder the Jews don't accept this. Why? Because they themselves are telling us, look, this is the problem. That the trial could not have taken place. Annas couldn't have done this. Caiaphas couldn't have done this. The 71 members of the Sanhedrin couldn't have done it before this time, before that time, before the Sabbath, before the Passover, during the Passover. It doesn't work like that. Then after that, Joseph of Arimathea, a made-up figure, who takes the body down, who shrouds the body himself, and he's supposed to be a rich man, a disciple of, I didn't even get to finish it clearly. John is telling us that he's a disciple of Jesus, a secret disciple who feared the Jews. The Jews who? The Sanhedrin, who he was a member. So why would John expose him? According to you, the scriptures were written there and then, according to you. Now you're telling me that John would write about one of his fellow disciples and say, this guy, he's actually a secret disciple. And then the Sanhedrin members are going to say, what, you expose us? Right, you're coming with us. Do you see? It doesn't make any sense. This is what I'm trying to say, that if the story before, prior to the execution, it's not even happened, it's not even true, nor the one after, then how could you even tell me that the crucifixion even happened, my friend? Do you see the problem that you're causing? Other than correcting the issue or like fixing it, you're jumping to the Quran. Jesus was taken up. How did he go up? When I die, do you even know the Arabic inna mutawafika? What does mutawafika mean? Do you even know that? Or are you just going to say, oh, I'm a Muslim guy who was born in a Muslim family? No. Inna mutawafika means, according to Ibn Kathir Tafsir, and I'm saying it on the top of my head, which I read many years ago. I'm just saying it on top of my head. I didn't even research it now. But inna mutawafika, according to Ibn Kathir Tafsir, I believe it was Ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhu, when he was asked, and he said it means when he was asleep. Mutawafika means asleep. Read the same when it comes to Idris alayhi salam in the Quran again. He was taken up as well. So we have to be consistent. I'm not a Muslim scholar, nor am I a mufti, nor am I exegesis of the Quran. So and this is what I'm saying based on what I read. But we can go details in this if that's need be. So I don't know why you jumped to the Quran when you couldn't even fix the issue yourself. Right. Let me try to sort this out. Right. Jesus dying on the, you're telling me, did he die? This is not me saying, my friend. This is what your scholars are saying. Professor Raymond Brown says, crucifixion pierces no vital organs. And so inevitably, one of the most wonders physicals, one must wonder what physical or organic factor caused Jesus to die. The extremely brief gospel description of the death of Jesus are of little help in answering this question. Historian of the New Testament, Dr. L. Michael White, sometimes the criminal was nailed, both hand and foot, and other times the hands were merely tied with ropes. The earliest representation of crucifixion of Jesus show the practice of using ropes alone for the arms, and much later did the tradition portray emerging Christian art. White, LM, page 133. So during the time of Jesus, according to a New Testament scholar, this would have been that Jesus would have been tied. Now you're telling me that the prophecy had to be fulfilled, that the bones had to, no bones will be broken, and no bones will pierce no bones. Can you prove it to me? Can you prove it to me, Chaka, that not a single bone of Jesus actually fractured or broke? Can you prove it to me? You're telling me the scripture says it, but can you tell me evidently that a single bone did not break or did not pierce or did not crack or something happened? Are you telling me if you claim nails went through his palm and then it went through his leg, that no bone, it scratched? I really doubt that, my friend. Someone like a five-year-old kid would probably fall for that, but someone educated like me, I don't think I'll fall for that. So that is a blunder itself. Let's carry on. I hope I got enough time. Right. The earliest, I don't even know why I should even address your topic. You were just talking about Acts 13, I believe. I'll get to that if I got time quickly. Acts chapter 2, verse 22. I'll get to that. The earliest mention of Jesus' resurrection is mentioned by Paul. Paul speaking about the resurrection raises a big problem. We read in 1 Corinthians 15:5. Paul speaks about Jesus after his resurrection, and that he appeared to Cephas and then the 12. I don't understand, Chaka, how they could have been 12 and not 11. Judas Iscariot, as seen from the Gospels, committed suicide before Jesus was crucified. And as follows from the book of Acts, Matthias was chosen to be the 12 instead of Judas. Already after Jesus' ascension, that means that throughout the whole of the time from Jesus' resurrection until his ascension, that is for 40 days, like you claim, Acts 1:3, there were always only 11, not 12. So why does Paul say 12 here? Maybe Chaka, you can tell us. Or Paul was, who was Paul referring to? If it's not Judas. Also, why did not Paul ever mention the women? Why did he dismiss Mary and the other women? I mean, that's something maybe you can explain to us. I mean, it seems to me a problematic situation there. Now, you were quote in Acts 22:24, I believe, that here, men of Israel, Jesus of Nazareth is a man attested to you by God mighty with mighty works and wonders, signs which God did through him in the midst of you. Jesus delivered up according to the definite plan of his foreknowledge of God. You crucified and killed by the hands of the lawless men, but God raised him up. That's what you said. Let's read Acts 13:28-31. Though they could charge him with nothing deserving debt, yet they asked Pilate to have him killed, and then they had fulfilled all that was written of him. They took him down from the tree and laid him in a tomb. Notice Paul is telling us in his sermon, in the sermon of the Acts, that they took him down and laid him in the tomb. So they killed him and they took him down. So who took him down, according to the Gospels, my friend? Joseph of Arimathea. According to the sermon in Acts 13, they took him down and they buried him in the, laid him in the tomb. Who is they? Surely Joseph of Arimathea never killed him, according to you. So you see, the problem that you're creating is that it's a never-ending story. What you're trying to do is you're trying to look. I can see the problem that it's created here. That you have a problem answering my questions, and that's fine. And I wouldn't expect you to answer it. The fact that you can't prove that Jesus was killed, because I've already given you a problem from the beginning and the end. If the Sanhedrin members, you cannot confirm regarding their situation historically and about Joseph of Arimathea, then you're stuck in the middle now. Do you know what I mean? And then now you're expecting to tell me, oh, then how did Jesus die? I'm just telling you, if the whole story was fake and it was made up, then what was the point even talking about it? What else did you say? John, did you say that Jesus... John the Baptist said... John the Baptist, for he so loved the world, he gave his son, and so on, so the lamb. That's a bit of a problematic statement for me. I don't know if you've read Luke 7:19. With all due respect, it doesn't seem that you're that familiar with the Bible. That's fine. But it seems in Luke chapter 7, verse 19, do you remember that verse, my friend, or do you want to look it up? When John the Baptist sends his angelos, his angels, his disciples, and what do they say? He sent them to the Lord to ask, are you the one who is to come, or should we expect somebody else? Now here we have a doubtful John the Baptist. In John 1:1, he's supposed, in John chapter 1, or in the John, he's supposed to be the lamb who came to the sins of mankind, the lamb to be slaughtered. But in Luke, we don't know if he's the right one or not. So you need to sort these problems out. And I don't want to shift. Maybe during the crossfire, we can talk about other problems that you haven't addressed. Coming back again, So if we have a problem with the crucifixion, the crucifixion and the resurrection, then what makes you think the crucifixion even happened? Oh, yes, sorry. I just want to address this point as well, that you said to me that I said that I'm basing my argument on Judas Iscariot. You said, oh, did you see how he first used Judas to say Judas was the one who done it? I don't know if you were listening to me, my friend. That was the whole point, to dismiss your argument. If Judas had done it, then it would have been a problem, because according to the scriptures, Judas could not have done it, because since Judas accepted a bribe, then the judges would have been part of his sin as well. So the judges wouldn't mean like that, because they are supposed to be learned Jewish men. They follow the Torah. Thank you.
Thanks for that, Mustafa. Right, we're going to move on to a dynamic part of the debate, a cross-examination. This is quite an exciting part, and hopefully it goes well. We're going to have 15 minutes for each debate participant to grill or cross-examine his debate partner. First up will be Chaka, and he'll have 15 minutes to interrogate Mustafa. So, Chaka, if you want to just take the mic, and I'll start your timing as soon as you ask your first question.
All right. Mustafa, I want to take you back to the book of Acts, chapter number 2 specifically, because you notice again you brought in the person of Paul, and that Paul did say this is the earliest source, you know, 1 Corinthians 15, that Paul is the earliest source. But also you say something to do with that, you know, if the gospel was written there and then, perhaps why would John be exposing Joseph of Arimathea? But again, these are basics, Mustafa. I don't think as a scholar I need to take you back to the fact that the gospel was actually not written there and there. I mean, this is just on the passing, but I want to take you to Acts chapter 2 and verse 22, and I do want to get your response on this. The first part, it says that, "Fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs which God did amongst you through him, as you yourselves know. This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him from the dead, fleeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him." Now, this the disciples, and Peter in particular, as a lead disciple here, talking to the leadership of Israel, and as I said earlier, the 3,000 as a result of this joined the church on that day. Are you telling us, Brother Mustafa, that all the 3,000 and Peter and the disciples were deceived by God?
No, I'm not on mute. Sorry about that. All right. So is that your question, my friend?
Yes, I just want us to engage on... Yes.
Okay. The question, I'm answering the question, but I just want to ask you simply, who wrote Acts? Just asking simply, who wrote Acts? Just generally, I'm just asking, who wrote Acts? Do you know? If you can answer that, if you can't, that's not a problem. I promise you, I'm not using it against you. I'm just saying, do you know who wrote Acts? Just on the safe side. Yes or no? Simple. Yes.
I'm going to have to butt in here. Mustafa, you can't ask a question.
Okay,
in this
fine.
Period.
All right, that's fine. Yeah. Okay, so Acts was written, it's the counterpart to Luke. You know that, and I'm sure you know that perfectly well. When did Luke write this, my friend? When did Luke write this? Luke must have written about 40 years later. So now he's giving us a description of what happened during the Pentecost, what, 40 years ago? And he's describing to us Luke, who he got it himself from somebody else. So that's fine, what he can write. That's not a problem. It's the same dispute that you're going to lay with anything else. You're basing your entire argument on Acts 2:22, when that is not even a valid argument. Peter spoke to 3,000 men, so 3,000 people, and then he conveyed the message that Jesus died, and then he raised up. Wow. That's a really strong argument, wouldn't you say? I don't see nothing strong about that. Luke is only, Luke is supposed to have writing what Peter had said. But even if Peter did say that, the crucial point here is Peter was not present during the crucifixion, according to Mark 14:20, if that's what we're going to use. 1450, sorry. So if Peter wasn't even present during the crucifixion, how would he even know Jesus was crucified? You have to take these points in note as well. You can't base your entire argument on just one verse and say, well,
okay, Peter, Mustafa, please allow Chaka to ask his next question.
All right. Just to take you back on this, you saying that Peter was not even there, and you quoting Mark 15, you know, that the disciples at the moment of Jesus Christ,
Mark 14, 50.
Yes, that the moment Jesus was being captured, they dispersed, they were scattered. And, you know, that is that Jesus had actually spoken about it. He said, you know, when I'll be arrested and you will be in a moment, you will be scattered. And this was actually a fulfillment of scripture, Zechariah chapter 13 and verse 7.
Okay.
That speak that, you know, strike the shepherd and the sheep will scatter. So that was actually a fulfillment of scripture. But if you clear enough to read Mark 15, just, you know, slightly after they got scattered, it does say that Peter did follow, and he was even during the trial, he was there with John, and John 19 records that even the mother of Jesus was there at the point of the cross.
Whose trial are you talking about?
Hold on, gentlemen. So Chaka, you've got to get to a question now. You've got to ask Mustafa a question.
Yes, I'm getting there. So Mustafa, the reason I'm saying that Acts 2 is important is because this is a message that is being addressed to the people. Now, if Luke is writing 40 years later, do you think we would rather cast doubt on Luke, who is writing 40 years later, according to you, and then accept a man that is writing 600 years later after the event and not at the venue, not at the scene of the event, but Luke is writing us and telling us the things that happened at the scene. So are you telling me, Brother Mustafa, that, let me ask, is there any of the disciples of Jesus, any of the Sahabas of Jesus, any of the men that walked with Jesus, who got out of that weekend Passover and said that the man that was on the cross was not Jesus, but it was somebody else?
Well, if you're asking me that question, then naturally I won't be able to, you won't find that in your Gospels now or your Bible, would you? That if that was there, then that would have been evident. You're talking from a biased side. You've already got books that are speaking for Jesus, not against Jesus. So
I'm allowing you to quote from any other source that quotes the disciples of Jesus, the very disciples of Jesus.
But we don't have any sort of first century information regarding disciples.
Thank so you. Where
would you expect me to even quote when you yourself want me to quote?
So we don't have any source that is telling us from the first century that is telling us that the person who died was so and so. But we do have the first century source that says the person who died was Jesus, right?
Well, according to Acts 22, is that what you're saying?
According to the book of Acts, before Paul, and I'm arguing my argument was before Paul, that we have the disciples of Jesus. They are preaching the message of the cross, right? And you don't have any other source from the first century that says they preached any other different message apart from the message of the cross.
Is that what you're saying? That if I have that, okay.
Your source is actually from the...
I don't know. Okay, my friend Chaka, I don't know if you're asking me a question or if you're...
I post because I want you to respond.
Okay, yeah. Okay, let me respond first. Right. So let me get this straight. What you're saying is that, is there any first century information where the disciples said that Jesus wasn't killed or crucified?
And that a different person actually died in place of Jesus.
We don't have any first century evidence. That's number one. Let's get this clear. Whether you want to ask for the Islamic side or the non-Islamic, there isn't any first century historical documents that we have found yet that would speak of anything. There is no, you don't even have a manuscript from first century, so forget about that.
That's the first thing.
Let me first finish.
Okay.
Secondly, you're basing your argument on writings that came much after the event. So if you're basing your argument like Acts or like the Gospel of Mark, something which came possibly 40 years plus, if you're basing your argument on that, then it's a very, very, very weak argument. That cannot be taken as literally strong argument.
Thank you, Mustafa. It is my time. Now,
okay, go on.
Before me, I have two bases that I can choose one. I have a choice of choosing a scripture that is written 40 years after the event, according to you, by Luke. And I have a source that is written 600 years later after the event. Now, mm-hmm. I have to choose between the two, which one to believe.
Now, you trust.
Good. So I want to take you again to Acts chapter 4. Acts chapter 4 is, just to give you a recap, is that the disciples have healed a person and they have been arrested. Now they have been released. And this is what their prayer was in verse 23, if you could read with me. On their release, Peter and John went back to their own people and reported all that the chief priests and elders said to them. When they heard this, they raised their voices together in prayer to God, saying, "Sovereign Lord," they said, "you made the heavens and the earth and the sea and everything in them. You spoke by the Holy Spirit through the mouth of your servant, our father David. Why do the nations rage and the people plot in vain? The kings of the earth rise up." And so the prayer goes on. And verse 27 says, "Indeed, Herod and Pontius Pilate met together with the Gentiles and the people of Israel in this city and conspired against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed. They did what your power and your will had decided beforehand should happen. Now, Lord, consider their threats and enable your servants to speak your word with great boldness. Stretch your hand to heal and perform signs and wonders through the name of your holy servant Jesus. After they prayed this, the place where the meeting was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly. Now, I know you've been all believing what Luke is saying here, but I want to ask you, Brother Mustafa, do you think this prayer genuinely prayed to God by the disciples right after the events, 50 or so days after the alleged crucifixion? Do you think this was a genuine prayer or it was an hypocritical prayer?
Personally, is that the question to me?
Yes, sir.
Is that your question now, yeah? Because with all due respect, it seems like you're like preaching to me and this is something I'm not expecting. But let me make it clear. You're telling me if this is a genuine prayer, which is fine. I mean, I don't know why your entire argument is based on the book of Acts. And I really don't see how that became relevant for the crucifixion. But you're just saying that the disciples said, you're believing what was written 40 years or 50 years later by Luke, who got it anonymously from someone else. You're expecting me to believe in this. So I don't see how that makes any sort of proof that what he wrote here seems to be a valid point for me. So you're telling me, okay, so this is where John and Peter, they prayed. They prayed it. So I believe in it. Do you believe in it? Well, I don't believe in it. Simple. You make me believe in it. What other ways can you make me believe that happened? That
actually, Mustafa, thank you. What I'm trying to say is this is a prayer.
Let me finish. I don't see how you're basing your argument of proving a point of a crucifixion by just nitpicking from Acts. That's not a credible way to convince me. I mean, I'm sure people who are listening, they're probably being a bit, hold on a second, what's going on?
Yeah, Mustafa, you've got to allow Chaka to proceed to his next question.
Okay. So the reason I keep pointing at this is, again, because you said the earliest source is actually Paul, and you were right in telling us that Luke is writing much later after the events. I'm straight to agree with you on that, but look at the time frame from the events, and you know the events are written, as you say, if they are written 40 years later. We know, for instance, and this is out of point though, but we know, for instance, that the Buhari and Muslim and all this, and the earliest source of
information. There you go. I expected that.
Guys, there's only 1 minute left. Yes, so Chaka, ask your question as quick as possible.
Good. I'm just giving an example. There are 200 years after the events.
Suppose you asked it. Tell me, why didn't they mention Joseph of Arimathea?
My 1 minute, Mustafa.
Yeah, why didn't they mention Joseph of Arimathea? Why didn't John and Peter and your Acts, why didn't they mention Joseph of Arimathea by any chance? Is there any reason why they blocked him off? I'm just asking simply. Since he's asked me, do I believe in it? I'm just thinking I have a doubt with it because it's not got Joseph of Arimathea mentioned in it. So how would you respond? Okay,
My response is simply what I'd already told you, that the narrators have not writing every specific story. I told you an example that John records the wine event and the other synoptic gospels not recorded. Does it mean that event did not happen? No, that event happened.
But doesn't chapter 4 of Acts tell us that John and Peter were unschooled?
They didn't time, gentlemen. Yeah. Right. So you did kind of both move on to Mustafa's Q&A. So Mustafa's going to have 15 minutes starting as soon as he begins to speak.
Right. Right. Mr. Chaka.
Yes, sir.
Can you show us any first century historical eyewitness who witness the crucifixion that's outside the Bible? Any first century, name me a first century historian or a person who witnessed the crucifixion of Jesus, and they wrote it down there and then, first century. Anyone. And I'll tell you, there's no point wasting time by saying Josephus or Tacitus or Philo, because it's not going to work. So can you give us a first century historian who witnessed the crucifixion, who saw it there and then? Because that will be fascinating if you say there is a first century historian, because we should take their gospels more stronger than yours. I'm understanding. So tell us a name, if you can. If not, I'll go to my next question.
I think the first, as you said earlier, the earliest source of the first century would be in the Bible, and that would be 1 Corinthians 15, as you earlier had mentioned, where Paul says that as according to the scriptures, Jesus was crucified and rose again from the dead, according to the scriptures. So when he's saying according to the scriptures, and that he appeared to 500 men, as you know, and he's saying some of them are dead, some of them have slept, but some of them are alive. In other words, you can actually inquire from them. So, and again, we need to understand that the stories were passed orally. But in terms of being written down, they were much written down much later. Outside of the Bible, at the moment, I cannot give you a historian.
Okay, that's fine. So I'm glad that you've admitted that there is no first century eyewitness or historians that have witnessed the crucifixion. That's point one. Now, you said again now, and I just want to point this out, you said that the stories were mentioned orally. You know what happens to oral tradition, right? They get twisted. So are you telling me that oral tradition that has been sent down could have had a twist, and then words could have been changed and meanings could have changed and even situations could have been changed and added, like the Chinese whisper?
Such possibility is very dim in regard to the crucifixion, and that's why I took you to the events that are happening 50 days on the day of Pentecost, the day of Shavuot, 50 days after the event, not 600 years later, my friend, 50 days after the event. And those people did not deny. They would have simply said, you know, Peter, we wanted to kill Jesus, but God deceived us, and we killed Simon, or we killed Judas.
Okay. You're going back to Acts, the Pentecost. That's not what I'm talking about. All I said was that, do you believe that the oral tradition can be twisted and words can be added in? And you said, yeah, again, going to the Pentecost. You're going to the scriptures that I'm talking about that could be changed. So you're not addressing the question. The question is, you admitted just now, and I pray that you don't.
Where do you get the idea that the scriptures can be changed?
You can be changed. Fine. The first point that you've admitted that you have no first century historians who witnessed the crucifixion and who saw there was an eyewitness. And secondly, that the oral tradition of the gospels of the scriptures can be changed. Okay, so that's two points that you've admitted to, which is fine. I'll make you admit to some other points. Now, when Mary Magdalene and the other Mary, the mother of Jesus, saw him, Mary Magdalene, when she saw Jesus, he was wearing gardener's clothing, according to John 20:15.
Right.
Yeah. Where did he get these gardener's clothes from? If his own clothes if his own garments were taken by the soldiers who divided them in lots, according to John 19:23. It's a counter question. Yeah, go on.
Yes, do you have any scripture that says that Jesus was wearing a gardener's clothes?
Well, she thought he was a gardener. How would she recognize he was a gardener?
He was a gardener. He doesn't say that he was that Jesus.
Let's get this straight. If I was gonna say, oh man, that person looks like a witch, then we have a description that they probably had some rugged and rough clothes. Their hair would have been bushed out, and they would have been like really dirty, evil looking. Now, when I say someone looks like a gardener, then naturally I'll understand what a gardener would look like. He'd probably have some sort of a garden fork or a shovel if they have that time. And he would have probably been wearing rugged clothes. Naturally, that would have been a description, because she thought he was a gardener. So it would have been a distinctive. Had he said, oh, he thought he was a scribe, he thought he was a rich man, he thought he was a fisherman, they would have had a description. So why was this description of a gardener placed on him?
Okay, simply the answer is very simple, because this woman is at the tomb very early in the morning on this Sunday morning. There is
was she alone in the tomb? Was she alone in the tomb, by the way? Was she alone in the tomb? Was she alone in the tomb?
There is nobody in terms of the man. There is nobody around around the tomb at this moment. And so she turns around, according to John chapter 20, and she looks at this man and thinks that it was a gardener. Now, if I would take you back to the disciples, Cleopas and all that, they walked with him. They did not even realize it was the resurrected Jesus. And so Jesus seems to have appeared with a glorified body after the resurrection. And so that is something.
That's fine, my friend. It's just going to drag on. You said that, that's fine. So you said that she was alone early morning in the tomb. And that's why she probably frightened and so on and so forth of him as a gardener. Now, the tomb was supposed to have, according to Matthew, okay, let's get this straight first. You said one woman, but according to Luke and Mark, we are told there were like many more. There were like three in Mark 16:1 and more than that in Luke 24:1. So if John is saying there was only one woman, that's singular, then why is Mark telling us there was more than one? They went together in the morning. And Matthew tells us as well, my friend, that the stone was rolled away. That's what Matthew's telling us. Now, if she went on her own in John 20, if she went on her own, how does she expect to roll that big massive stone away? What kind of a woman can roll such a heavy stone away when an angel came down and rolled it? That's how big the stone was. Now, can you explain that to me as well?
All right. The first thing that we need to understand is that at this point, the women and the disciples indeed are not, it has not come into their mind that the Messiah is supposed to resurrect. Jesus had spoken about his death and resurrection, but at this point, the disciples do not even believe it. Even
brother, I asked how many women.
You are asking me whether
how many women? How many women saw them? I'm asking how many women, because my question, I don't want it to get dodged away time-wise. I said to you, John says one woman, and then Mark and Matthew and Luke tells us women. So I want to know how many. Was it singular or was it plural? Because if it is singular, then the plural synoptic have been flawed off as fabricated, and if it's plural, then the singular, which is John, has been flawed off as fabricated. You can't have them both. And how was she managed to pull that such a huge stone away, according to Mark, Luke? How would have she moved that stone away? And Matthew tells us it was an angel.
I think you're forgetting something.
Which is?
For instance, if I was talking to you right here and I said that, that Ali or prepared the debate, Ali was speaking to people, it doesn't basically mean that it's one person. If I say that I did...
Brother, that's a weak argument. Please, don't even try that argument. That's not going to work. I want something more stronger than that. Your arguments are really weak, man. I know you've lost this debate, but you're just making it worse on you.
Mustafa, just make
it stronger, my brother.
I already told you earlier before that the fact that John mentioned one particular narration, and if you go to look, for instance, chapter 8, he does mention the women that served Jesus, even with their substance. He mentioned Salome and all this. So the fact that that John is following the story of Mary Magdalene, it does not mean that Salome was not there. It does not mean that the other Mary.
Why did John say she went on her own?
Say that again.
Why did John say she went on her own? Okay, you know what? You won't be able to answer that. Let me carry on quickly. I don't want to lose my time.
No. Does John say that that Mary went alone and that there was no other person?
Well, if you read John, there is absolutely no indication to state she was with anybody else but herself. Read it. You read it and then you get back to me and tell me there was.
You are right. And I'm saying just because he's...
Well, why should you miss it out for? This is what I'm saying.
Does not mean that there was no other narrator.
Okay. You know what? This is too difficult. Oh, that's fine. Look at did Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus, were they aware that Jesus would resurrect after 3 days? I want to know a yes or no, because my question will come after that. Did they know he will resurrect after 3 days? Yes or no?
I'll answer that with Mark chapter 9, verse 9.
They did know. They did know he would resurrect.
Let's just read together, if you allow me.
Because my time wise, my brother, I just want to know a simple yes or no. Did Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus, did they know that Jesus was going to rise after 3 days? Yes or simple no? That's
yeah,
it.
Chaka, you've got to give a yes or no here.
The disciples were not, it wasn't in their mind at that moment that he would rise.
So also they didn't know he was going to rise, no?
He had spoken about it. It had not come into their mind. It's only later on after the resurrection that they recall these things that he had told them.
That's fine. So if according to John, that the Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea, they already had aloes and herbs with a linen shroud, and they already covered him up with spices and herbs. Why did the other ladies go in to spice him up again? Because you won't be able to do it twice. Why was that?
Luke does tell us why they were going there. They were going to prepare his body.
A woman cannot prepare the body of a man. Are you aware of that?
We'll say that.
Yeah? Are you aware of that? In Jewish tradition, a woman does not prepare the body of a man.
Look, the events before Jesus was crucified, Mark 24, does tell us about a woman who,
I'm asking you, did women, according to the Jewish tradition and laws, did they perform the preparation for the men's after they passed away, yes or no? Did women take that role? Just a simple yes or no. No.
Are you talking of sources outside the Bible?
Yeah, outside. I mean, come on, everything isn't found in your Bible. Naturally, it's going to be outside the Bible as well. I'm talking the Jewish jurisprudence, my friend. Generally asking. Listen, you have to be really careful how you answer this, because if this is recording and the Jews, they really see this, they'd be really upset. You're telling me, are you trying to tell me that a woman, a singular, or let it be women, many, they are allowed to go inside and then they can prepare a dead body of a man? A dead body of a man will be fully naked. Are you trying to tell me that they'll strip him apart and they're just going to cover him like that? I mean, you have to be consistent, my brother. You can't just floor in anything that you want and just because you want to. It's not going to work like that. You have to be consistent. If Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea, if they had taken the spice and herbs and aloes, according to, I believe, John 19, 23 or 39, then why would the women go in there as well? There's absolutely no need for them to go in there in the first place. They wouldn't have had to. It just doesn't work. I don't want to get into another dialogue.
The women, actually, according to the gospel, that the women were there as Joseph and Nicodemus brought down this body. Do you know that the women were there?
Yeah, I know. They said we come to see.
All right. No.
They said we come. They went to see. They didn't go to do any sort of.
So they saw the things that had happened and they left.
So why would they come back after 3 days and again to do it, my brother? How would that work?
Because it's very clear. Luke tells us it was the Sabbath.
There's nothing clear. You're telling me that Muslims got it wrong. It seems like your scriptures have got it wrong, bro. And I've not even started, and I wish we had more time. I've got so much to talk to you about these stuff that it's.
There's
really
only 1 minute left, Mustafa. Okay. If you want to ask a question.
Okay, right. Let me ask the question about it. You can't name us by any chance who those 500 people that Jesus saw, that is saw. Can you give us any evidence that Jesus actually met 500 people by any chance?
The source I can give you is the source you just quoted, 1 Corinthians 15, and you said very clearly that it's the earliest source.
Why didn't he mention Mary Magdalene?
The earliest source.
Why did he not mention Mary Magdalene
in the century of the event?
Yeah. Did he not mention Mary Magdalene and Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus together to say they are the one who put the body in the tomb? Why is the empty tomb missing from the first earliest, according to you, evidence? Why is the empty tomb missing?
It is not, the empty tomb is not missing in 1 Corinthians 15, which is the earliest verse. In 1 Corinthians 15, 20, it says, actually, if we are preaching the gospel that Jesus was crucified and was not crucified and he was not raised, then we are most to be pitied. But the verse 20 says, but thank God, he has been raised from the dead. And so
time.
I don't see the where the empty tomb is.
Time, gentlemen.
15:20.
Okay. Thank you.
So, right. Thanks for that. That was quite lively. It was a bit difficult to control, but thanks for that. Now, Chaka's going to finish off his portion with a 5-minute closing statement. So, Chaka, if you want to go ahead, and I'll start your time as soon as you commence.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to take us back to the subject. The subject is a scripture that comes 600 years after the event, and what does it say? Wama katalu, wama swalabu, wala kinshubi yalahum. They did not crucify him, they did not kill him, but so it was made to appear to them. The Muslim world today as we speak, Shabila Ali, for example, and many other Muslim scholars of this day, do not agree on what actually happened on that fateful day. What happened to Jesus? Where is Jesus right now, according to Islam? Islam cannot answer that. The substitution theory that Mustafa hold cannot answer that. The swoon theory that some Muslims hold cannot answer that. The legend theory that some Muslims hold cannot answer that. The natural death theory that is being held by the Muslims, some from other Muslims like Ahmadiyyas, cannot hold to this. What am I saying? If you come back, and I want to bring us back to chapter 3 and verse 55, by the call Allah, Ya Isa, inni mutawafika wa rafika ilayya. Remember when Allah said, Ya Isa, I will cause you to die. I will fulfill your days, and then I will bring you to myself. If he has been brought to, he has been taken up, surely the first thing has happened. In Surah 7, verse 24, all the way to verse 26, Allah says that, O children of Adam, you will dwell on earth you will die, and there you will be raised in the Yawmul Qiyamah. Nowhere in the Quran does it say that somebody will be taken up, and then he will come to die again later. There is no such a thing according to the Quran. Surah 21, Surah Al-Anbiya, verse 7 and verse 8, it says, that all the prophets before the Prophet Muhammad ate food, and they were men. They were not to live forever and die, but they were to die as other men. So there is no other person who is alive before Muhammad, according to Surah 21. And verse 34 of Surah Al-Anbiya says, no other mankind is actually alive. Back to the Quran. And we could go on to many other verses. How do I understand Surah 4 and verse 157? This is how I understood. The Jews were boasting, saying that they are the one that have killed the Messiah. Allah is not denying that the Messiah died, but is denying the boasting of the Jews. What actually happened, just like in Badr, the Battle of Badr, Surah 8 and verse 17, The Muslims were boasting that they were the ones that had killed the Mushrikun. And Allah is saying, you did not kill them, but we did. In other words, no other soul leaves man before Allah says, before God says, you know, that the soul shall die. And therefore, if God had permitted that the soul of the Messiah should die, then the Jews had no way to boast that they were the ones. Actually, Jesus says in John chapter 10 and verse 17, no man takes away my life. I lay it down. The Messiah laid his life down for the sheep. He says, no one takes it away. I have the power to lay it down, and I have the power to raise it up. And so the Messiah did voluntarily give his life for us. No man took it. That is how I understand Surah 4, verse 157, that what they are being denied there is not the actual crucifixion of the Messiah. Is the fact that the Jews were boasting and telling Muhammad, we will kill you as we killed the Messiah. And therefore, Allah is denying, just as he's denying the events of Badr, that when Muslims were boasting, and he's telling them, no, you are a small army. You did not kill them. It is Allah who did it. In the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 32 and verse 39, the Bible says it's actually God who kills and God who restores. And so if Jesus wasn't willing to do it, he surely would have not died. He was willing. He says, I can call my father and he will bring me legions of angels and they would take him away from the cross. But Jesus gave his life for us. What am I saying? That even as you read more verses of the Quran, you will find that the act the Muslims are telling us that somebody else died or these are the events that happened. There's no such a thing. The Quran says, "Kullu nafsi dha'iqatul maut." Every soul shall test death. In Surah 19, verse 33, Isa says, "Peace be upon me the day I was born, the day I died, and the day I shall resurrect." And Muslims can say, you know, that is in future tense. He shall die. It's in future tense. It's the time to come. But if you go to Surah Al-Zumar,
time. You can finish off your point, Chaka.
Yeah, let me finish on that. So if you read Surah 39 and verse 30 and 31, Allah is speaking to Muhammad and saying, "You shall surely die." So the Quran, Muhammad is dead now, but the Quran says, "You shall die." It is in the future. So even in the case of the Messiah, when it says, "Peace be upon me, the day you shall die," though it is in the future tense, the event has already happened when the Quran, as I read Surah 3, verse 55, when Allah says, "I will cause you to die, then I will bring you to myself." Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Okay. Right, Mustafa, I'm just going to unmute you. You're going to have 5 minutes to close off, which will begin as soon as you commence speaking.
Am I on?
Yeah, you're on.
Thank you very much. Thank you for this debate. It was a brilliant debate. We spoke about a lot of stuff. I'm a bit upset that Chaka could not answer my question, which is fine, and I didn't expect him to anyway. Now, I don't know why Chaka was constantly running to the Quran. I mean, he's saying the Quran came 600 years later. Would I accept the Quran or would I accept... It doesn't matter if the Quran comes 600 years later. For us, it is the truth. It is timeless truth from Allah. So it's like the Christians when the Torah came, 3,500 years ago, New Testament comes 1,500 years later, and then you supersede that. You say, no, the Gospels are now superior than the Torah. Do you see the problem that you're creating? And when you say, what happened to Jesus, Muslim can't answer, yes, we can. He did not die. End of simple. Now we don't have the Quran did not have to emphasize that Jesus about the crucifixion. Something which is already a lie, then there is no point emphasizing on this. Let's make this clear. Secondly, you have to understand that you're telling me, oh, Muslims, and one says this, and one uses this theory, and one says he died. Dr. Shabir Ali said this, so and so. I'm really upset. I wouldn't use someone as credible as Dr. Shabir Ali in this debate anyway. So he's a scholar. He's on another level. We leave him where he is in his level. I'm talking about myself. I'm saying to you, my friend, that when you cannot answer basic questions that I asked you about the crucifixion, the problems of the resurrection, the problems of the women in the empty tomb, the problems is the Council of Sanhedrin, the problem with Joseph of Arimathea. This is conjecture that you follow, my friend. You're constantly running to the Quran and say, oh, I believe that the Quran, Jesus did not die. How did you come to that belief? I don't understand. You're quoting Surah 5, 157. The Quran doesn't say that he died. The problem is you didn't even finish the whole ayat. They said in boast, we killed Christ, Jesus, the son of Mary, the messenger of Allah, but they killed him, not crucified him, but it was made to appear to them. And as those who differ therein are full of doubts, with no certain knowledge, but they follow conjecture to follow for surety, they killed him not. What does Surah Zukhruf say? Chapter 43, that he will be the sign of the hour. Jesus, Isa alayhi salam, will come back. We understand that. And then I don't know why you switch. And I think your motive was to tell your audience, oh, look, Jesus is still alive. Jesus is still alive. And the prophet or the Islamic prophet, he's no longer alive. I don't know why you, it's one of these problems that you create. when you can't answer a question yourself and you'll just jump to the Islamic sources. I think that's a problem. We believe as Muslims and we have authentic hadith that the prophets are all alive. They don't die. Allah says in the Quran in a couple of places, those who have been killing the way of Allah, do not say that they have died. No, they are alive. They are with Allah. So people even who are martyred, they are still alive. The prophets of Allah are still alive. We don't have a problem with that. Do you know what I mean? And so in the sense of saying that, was Jesus killed or was he not killed? No, he was still alive. And nobody killed him. He was alive. The fact that your gospels have created such a problem, and then you cannot answer those, it says a lot. You know what I mean? So I think it's a really bad move, my friend, by taking that option, by running to the Quran. The other problems that you were constantly running to was, I don't know why you were constantly running to the Quran. You were just jumping. I don't know why. Maybe you need to... Okay. There's a hadith which is found, narrated Aus ibn Aus. The Prophet ﷺ said, amongst the most excellent of the days is Friday. On Adam, Adam was created. On it he died. And on it the last trumpet will be blown. And on it the shout will be made. So invoke more blessing on me for that day. For your blessing will be submitted to me. The people asked the Messenger of Allah, how can it be our blessing will be submitted to you while your body is decayed? He replied, Allah the Exalted has prohibited the earth from consuming the bodies of the prophets. So this is hadith. The bodies of the prophets are still alive. They're not dead. So I'll rephrase the ayat. I don't want to say it wrong. So let's be consistent, my friend.
Time.
I finish? Oh.
Yeah, well, you can finish off your last thought.
I just want to make my points that I've asked you questions regarding the Sanhedrin and the problems prior to the crucifixion, and after you could not answer those questions. You admitted that the Gospels were written later. You admitted that there are oral traditions. You've admitted to that. You admitted there is no first century historians that witnessed the crucifixion. So you've admitted the three main problems that we have. You've admitted to those. You've even admitted that corruption could have come in the text. And you're constantly using Acts 4 or 3, which is no good. So you could not prove anything to me, my friend. You could not justify your claims. You could not answer my questions. And you totally went off subject, off topic. You're trying to be a mufassirun, trying to interpret the Quran yourself. And that is unjust. You shouldn't have done that. So I recommend that you go and do more of your research, my friend, and then come back and we can discuss it more. To me, you've lost this debate. Jazakallah khair. Assalamu alaikum.
Well, thanks to both participants.